emerging from the darkness of four stories of stairs. He finds everything ready for the festival of Passover. The court of the Gentiles is filled with stalls that are full of cattle, sheep, and doves for the required sacrifices. The money changers at their tables are exchanging denarii for shekels. Everything is in order. Everything is operating exactly as it is supposed to, according to the system established for worship in this temple, until Jesus arrives. Until Jesus arrives and makes a whip of cords to drive out the cattle and sheep. Until Jesus arrives and pours out the coins of the money changers and flips over their tables. Until Jesus arrives and commands them to take these things out of here and stop making my Father's house a marketplace. Jesus' actions and words are a powerful critique of this ancient temple system, which promotes a transactional relationship between God and humanity. In this system, humans offer domestic animals as sacrifices, as substitutes, as stand-ins for themselves, to receive the punishment they thought they deserved by being burned up on a massive stone altar in front of the holy place. By these sacrifices, they demonstrated their submission to God, sought to appease God's wrath, cleanse their impurities, atone for their sins and their guilt, give thanks for their blessings received, and come closer to God. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace. Destroy this temple. With his actions and words, Jesus completely overturns this marketplace, transactional, sacrificial way of relating to God out there, far, far away, high above the heavens. In its place, Jesus offers the temple of his body, where the divine word becomes flesh, where God is fully embodied, human like us in every way. No one understood. It wasn't until Jesus was raised from the dead that the disciples remembered and understood that we find God in Christ's body. Caroline Lewis writes, Jesus is saying that his body is the location of God, and yours is too. It has to be. God is counting on it, because God loves the world. Jesus is counting on it, because his incarnation came to an end on the cross. You and I, each of us individually, is an embodiment of the image of God, filled with Christ's Spirit. You and I together are the body of Christ visible in the world. We gather here in this place each Sunday and Wednesday to be reminded where God is found, to show each other what God looks like and sounds like in this world that God loves so much. There is a scene at the end of C.S. Lewis's book, The Voyage of the Dawn Treader, that illustrates this idea. Lucy and Edmund's third adventure in Narnia is at an end, and they must return to their own world. Aslan reveals that this will be their last visit to Narnia. The children are bereft. Lucy sobs, "How can we live, never meeting you again?" And Aslan assures them that he is in their world too, saying, "But there I have another name. You must learn to know me by that name. This is the very reason why you were brought to Narnia, that by knowing me here for a little, you may know me better there." I'd like to suggest that coming to church is kind of like a wee trip to Narnia, but better. Because we are not limited to only three visits, we can come as many times as we want. We can come every Sunday and Wednesday for our whole lives. Coming to church gives us an opportunity to momentarily step into an alternate reality, a a time and place where the rules of the marketplace are set aside, where transactional relationships, sacrifice, and punishment are replaced by the proclamation of God's unending love, grace, and mercy, and the all-inclusive sharing of the Lord's Supper, where we catch glimpses of God in the fresh faces of children and in the weary but oh-so-wise eyes of the elderly, where we put our bodies to work packing food for the hungry, offering hospitality to the homeless, gathering resources to care for those who are given up as lost. We go out of here on the best occasions with our minds and hearts renewed, our eyes and ears open to see and hear what God is doing in the world, to see and hear how God is calling us to do God's work with our hands in our homes, our schools, our places of work, in our neighborhoods. To help us recognize what God might be calling us to do this week, let us turn to our First Testament lesson from Exodus 20. Hear again the words that God speaks to God's chosen people, past and present. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. This is how we recognize God, as the one who seeks to liberate us from every system that diminishes the dignity and value of some persons by glorifying and privileging others. Whether we call that system racism, patriarchy, sexism, economic inequality, human trafficking, whatever title you want to put to it. My question to you is, how do these systems prevent you or your loved ones from flourishing? How might you be complicit in these systems? And what can you do to flip these tables? You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol. In Luther's large catechism, he tells us that a god is whatever we trust and believe in to bring us all good, keep us secure, and provide refuge in our need. Who or what is the first and foremost source of your security and defense in times of trouble? Is it your bank account? Your pension fund? Your power and influence? Your fame and prestige? Your family and friends? Your guns? Your opiates? Your addictions? Have they become idols, replacing God as the source of all that is good in your life? How will they keep you safe and secure, or bring you comfort and strength when cancer strikes, when your loved ones die, when you yourself are dying? What idolatrous tables need to be flipped in your life? Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. God comes to us in Sabbath times. God re-energizes us when we give our bodies, minds, and spirits time to rest, recuperate, and recover from the sicknesses and sorrows we will inevitably encounter in life. God heals and restores us to wholeness and well-being when we allow ourselves to be cared for. What tables need to be flipped so that all people can truly experience Sabbath? Honor your father and your mother. It is easy to honor if you have grown up in a family where parents have been loving, caring, and supportive. But how do we honor when there is so much abuse, neglect, isolation, and so little help within a family, within a community? What tables need to be flipped in your home, in your workplace, your school, or your neighborhood? You shall not murder. You shall not steal. You shall not covet anything that belongs to your neighbor. Jesus expands these words, urging his followers not to be angry, insulting, or putting down anyone. Luther's small catechism urges us to neither endanger nor harm the lives of our neighbors, but instead to help and support them in all of life's needs, to help them improve and protect their property and their ability to earn an income? What tables need to be flipped so that all people have fair and equitable access to food, to personal hygiene products, education, health care, wages, homes, everything? You shall not commit adultery. You shall not bear false witness. Faithfulness to your spouse in deeds and in words, absolutely. But the Bible expects even more. Jesus insists that adultery includes looking at anyone with lust. The bodies of women and girls, boys and men, are not objects to be used or abused for anyone's personal pleasure or power. Neither are they commercial commodities in the marketplace. Our bodies and the bodies of our neighbors are like Jesus' body. Temples of God's Spirit, sacred and holy places where human soul and divine spirit dwell together intermingled. What tables need to be flipped so that every body, everywhere and always, is treated with dignity and respect? What tables need to be flipped to create safe spaces for the abused to tell their stories without judgment, gossip, slander, or lies? What tables need to be flipped so that abusers can take responsibility for their actions and change? Please pray with me. Truth be told, Jesus, there are lots of tables that need overturning in our lives. So perhaps, Jesus, today, you could pay us a visit and help us to rearrange the furniture. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Amen. I invite you.